Okay, this script is going to talking about the analysis of the bridge task and is also involved with the load distribution from the depth of the bridge task to the stringer and to the floor beam and to the truss. And after finish distribution of the loading to the truss, we will analyze the truss to find the forces in the truss member, and also finally we will find the maximum tension force and maximum compression force that we use to design this truss. Okay, let's come into the problem statement. The problem statement says a civil engineer graduate from HUT is assigned to design the bridge truss as shown. When you decide to bridge truss, that means you're going to start by the scratch. You're going to start by setting up what the size of the truss should be, how big is your truss bridge, and you also supposed to make the model of the truss, do the load distribution, and do the analysis and do the design. And before we start, let us go back to what we call the truss. As you can see from the pictures below, the truss composed of stress member, and then they are fabricated to form the triangular shape. This triangular shape is the stable shape, unlike the rectangular that is unstable. And then the truss will form by welding the joints together to make the whole truss. In actuality, when we build this truss, we will separate the worker into two groups. One for fabricating the truss, another group is for building the support. And then when the support finish, you use the crane to lift the truss and put them into the position. And then when these two panel truss are in position, you got to connect them by using the floor beam. Okay, and then you also put the cross beam on the top of the truss. And then you put the stringer across the length of the truss. And finally, you may put the deck onto the truss. Most of the time, the deck can be the precast or precast reinforced concrete beam. It's up to your design. And thinking about that, all the truss must joist by straight long member. And then when we analyze the truss, we're gonna make some assumption. And what the assumption that we have? Just recall from the static, the assumption that we first said is the truss has the frictionless pin. So the joists of the truss is going to be frictionless pin. Again, in reality, the joist is not that connect by the pin. It's connect by the welding. Yes, actually it's connect by the welding and using the gasket pad, as I mentioned before. And I already show you that by assuming this is kind of a fixed joist and compare the result with the assumed pin joint, the result are quite the same. And now I think this assumption is quite correct. And the second is very important, the loading, the load X at the joint. By loading at the joint, this means you form the truss member that are pin at the bolt end and no applied force between the member. And if you recall from the instatic, what we call this kind of member, you may recall this is going to be two force member, okay? And the two force member may be in tension or maybe in compression. I should make a note that when we decide the thrust member, if the thrust is in tension, the force will tend the thrust element and it can take a lot of forces, and beware the connection of the thrust member. However, when the thrust subjected to compression, the thrust member may fail by the buckling. So when you decide it, you got to check not only the stress in the thrust, you also need to check the buckling for the thrust member. And then we come to the mechanics of material. On the mechanics of material, we did make some more assumption when we analyze the structure. If you may recall, the third that we have is under the force or loading. Okay, the thrust material we have most of the thrust material is steel. Most of the time is steel. We have linearly elastic. And if you may recall back, when you study the mechanics of material, we put the steel in tension. And then we have the stress strain diagram of the steel, especially the structural steel, like this. And then we determine what? We determine the yielding stress. And then we reduce the yielding stress to be the sigma allowed by divided the yielding stress by the factor of safety of 2.0. So this assumption mostly is correct. And the last one, under the forces and loading, the deformation of the thrust member, also the thrust is very small. As you may recall, when we decide the thrust, we limited the allowable deflection of the beam to be span over 240 if this beam have no wall under it. That means what? That means if your beam is 240 centimeter long, the maximum deflection occur is allowed only 1 centimeter. Okay, that is going to be quite small compared to that. And also, when we analyze the thrust, analysis of thrust, we use two methods to do so. One is the method of section. If you may recall, this method of section, you cut the thrust into a portion. For example, you have this thrust, and then this thrust subjected to the force. And then if you like to determine the force in internal member of the thrust, for example, if you like to find the forces in the member of this thrust, it is better for you to cut part of the thrust to be what's so called a section. And then if you analyze for the reaction at the support, and then you may determine the force inside the thrust. If the thrust is subjected to the force like this, and then you can compare it with when you bend the pen, you can see the bottom is going to be in tension and the top is going to be in compression. So by doing this, this thrust going to have the tension force on the bottom chord and compression in the top chord, okay? And you also have the force in the diagonal member. If you trying to analyze this, it's going to be what? It's going to be the rigid body. Under the action of the force, all the thrusts are in equilibrium. So when you cut only the portion of the thrust, this portion of the thrust also going to be in equilibrium. Since the portion of the thrust has three unknowns, you're going to prevent this section of the thrust to be stable in the X direction. Also, it's going to be stable in the Y direction, and the rotation of this portion must be zero. This is condition that we use in the analysis of equilibrium of rigid body in the engine static. Again, this method is good if we are looking for the forces inside of the thrust. However, in the case that you are only interested in the force of the thrust member in this area, and you may can see by considering this area, and then you cut it, what do we have? You're going to have the free body diagram of the joints of the thrust, and when you put this reference axis, and then the joint subjected to the no reaction. And what happened is, since the thrust is in equilibrium, so when you cut the joint also in equilibrium. When the joint in equilibrium, that means the thrust member gonna have internal forces. By doing that, and you may know that when you bend this thrust again like this, this thrust member going to have tension. Okay, when this thrust have the tension, and this one has pointing upward, that means this member supposed to have this kind of compression. And when you know the angle or the ratio of the incline of this member, you can see this joint is going to have two unknown. This is called the method of joints. The method of joint is good, J-O-I-I-I-N-T, is good for analysis of the joints that has two unknown forces. And then the method of joint is based on the concept of equilibrium of particle. So the joint is considered as the particle. And then each joint going to have only two equations because the particle have no dimension. So there is no equilibrium equation for the moment. So, in conclusion, when you analyze thrust, you're supposed to select which method you're supposed to use. If you like to find the forces inside the thrust, I recommend you to use the method of joint. And if you like to find some specific forces near the joint, near the support, or at the joint that has only two unknown, it's better to use the method of joints. Okay? And then we come to our problem from this. We start to take a look at the truss as the bridge truss that we have. And then from the start, I'm talking about how do we construct this bridge truss by building the foundation. And then you also fabricate the truss. You move the truss into position. And then you link the truss by the forebeam and the top bar. And then you put the stringer, connect the forebeam, and then you put the deck over it. Okay. And then the bridge truss gonna have the dead load. That is the weight of the structure and the weight of the floor. And also it's going to have the life load. What the life load come from? It's come from the vehicle that's passing by the truss bridge. Okay. Let us start by take a look what we have here. The first thing, the truss has the dead load due to the 0.2 millimeter thick reinforced concrete deck. What this mean is the reinforced concrete when it has the volume of 1 cubic meter, that means it's going to be 1 meter here, 1 meter here, and 1 meter here. The weight of this going to be 24 kilonewton per cubic meter. However, since the slab is only, since the deck is only 0.2 meter, so that means we consider only this portion of the reinforced concrete. So we can compute the weight per square meter of the RC deck by time 24 kilonewton per cubic meter by its thickness. And then you get the dead load of 4.8 kilonewton per square meter. And then the truss is not have the deck, the truss also have its own member and the falling system. Most of the time, engineers must estimate the dead load of the component of the bridge truss. The estimation of this portion of the bridge truss come from the experience, mostly. And when you are the new engineer, this is better to ask your senior for the estimation of the dead load. By this problem, the estimated dead load is 1.2 kilonewton per square meter. So the total of the dead load gonna be 6 kilonewton per square meter. And then we will have the estimate life load. Is going to estimate according to the Department of Transportation. If it's this bridge made in Thailand, you got to use the Department of Transportation code of Thailand. Okay, if you work for your country, you're going to also check which code you're going to use. And this one is 4 kilonewton per square meter. So the total of this is what we have, the total load. Okay. The total load is equal to death load plus the life load. And what you get here is 4.8 plus 1.2. And then you also put 4. This is due to the life load. So the total of the load that distribute all the area of the deck is going to be 6 plus 4 is going to be 10 kilonewton per square meter. The force actually going to be cover the whole area of this bridge truss, okay, and it's covered everywhere because of the assumption of the load that's distributed per square meter. So the loading actually supposed to be like this. And then this load will transfer to the decks and then transfer to the stringer and transfer to the beam. And the next, the problem said the load transferring from the reinforced concrete deck to the stringer is one-way action. By putting like this, the load gonna transfer in one-way action. You gonna connect what you are designed to the real construction. So let me trying to draw the floor plan of this truss. And from this, it said the deck panel length AB, BC, and CD, DE is going to be 4 meters. So what we have here is the span of this bridge truss is 16 meter, and each of the panel length is going to be 4 meter. So this is going to be 4 meter, 4 meter, 4 meter, and 4 meter. Okay. And also the width of this truss is going to be 9 meters. So the width is the distance here. That is going to be 9 meters. And then it says the deck panel is fully attached to the stringer. Oh, this is not that hard. If you have the stringer here, okay, and then during the build, you may use the shear key put on the top of this. And then when you cast the concrete, okay, the concrete going to cover the shear key, okay, and if this one the concrete deck and this is the shear key, the concrete going to connect, okay, the deck with the shear key, and they're going to fully attach it to the stringer. It does not lay on the bottom of the top cord. If we cut here, and then we have the cord of this one. This is the truss, okay. What it mean is we have the floor beam that connected by this stringer. So the floor is just close to the member of the truss. There is no force that's transferred to the bottom cord of the truss. If there is force transferring from the decks into the bottom cord of the truss, we cannot use the assumption that we mentioned to analyze the truss. In that case, the truss is going to be the frame. Okay, analysis is going to be very hard to do so by hand. Usually, if you put the force from the slab into the truss member, you can analyze the truss by using the computer. That's going to be in your future. Okay, next. It said, the length between the inside stringer is 3 meters. So by doing this, that means the distance between the inside stringer is going to be 3 meters and 3 meters. And the length between stringer and the bottom cord of the truss, that means this length is going to be 1.5 meter, and this is also gonna be 1.5 meter. And then it said the length of the truss BF which is BF. This is the length of the task BF. The length, this length is going to be 3 meters. So that is the height of the task. Okay, so now what we have is all dimension of the task. All of them are in 3 dimension. It is better to draw the floor plan of this task in 2 dimension. Okay, by doing this, let's check. This truss width going to be 9 meter width, the total is 9 meter, and 16 meter long. If you use the scale, let's see, 9 meter is 4.5 centimeter. If you set 4.5, that's mean you're going to use 2 meter per 1 centimeter. And then you're going to get your floor beam. Okay, that is going to be E. And let's say this one is the E palm. And then you have 4 meter. So that means you're going to put it like 2 centimeter, 4 meter, 4 meter. 4 meter and 4 meter. By putting this, you're going to put in this truss also. This is button cord of another truss. 2 meter, 2 meter, 2 meter, and 2 meter. Okay, and then you put the floor beam. This is a floor beam. Link the truss together. So the two tasks will work in harmony. And this guy is going to be 9 meter long. Okay, and we put this one as the A, B, C, D, and E. And then this one going to be D palm, C palm, B palm, and this one is the A palm. And we have what? Then we need to build the stringer. So the stringer is going to be 1.5. 1.5 is 0.75. This is going to be about 0.75. And then 3 meter is going to be like 1.5. So we put the stringer. Okay. Like this, and then the all of them must be simple beam. This one also like this, and then you put all the stringer on the stringer to the floor beam. And then when you finish putting the stringer, you put the deck into the stringer. Since the assumption that the force is one way action, most of the time when we build this beam, we going to put the precast slab onto this beam, and then put it like this. 1, 2, 3, 4. Each of them may have 1 meter width. Okay, and then we put this like this. Okay, and then when you construct this bridge, you may put the temperature steel on the top and put the concrete topping into it to link all of the precast slab together. Okay, by doing this, what we get This is going to be 4 meter, 4 meter, 4 meter, and 4 meter. This is 1.5 meter, 3 meter, 3 meter, and 1.5 meter. So the floor plan as shown here is going to be kind of simple to understand, right? It's better than the 3D floor beam there. Okay, next, we got to consider the way that the load gonna transfer from the concrete deck into the stringer. Let's just consider this stringer first. Okay, by putting the precast concrete slab in this way, the load can transfer half to the beam like this, and another half into this beam. So the distributed area of the force for the center beam is going to be like this. And for the left beam, it's going to be like this. And also for the right beam, it's going to be like this. And you may consider this load distribution area. Since this is 3 meters, so the width going to divide this one going to be 1.5 meters. And this is going to be 1.5 meters, 1.5 meters, and 1.5 meters. So the total width that the load transfer to this stringer is going to be 3 meters. And since the floor attached along the length of this stringer, so the stringer gonna subjected to uniformly distributed load. And what the span of this stringer? The span of this stringer is 4 meters. Okay, let's just start. If this is 4 meters stringer, let's set this one as the simple beam. With this is what? This is this point. This point is S. And this point is R. Let's say this point is R. And it's subjected to the uniformly distributed force from the yellow floor. Okay. And what this is 4 meter beam, 4 meter stringer, and what the size of the uniformly distributed force acting on this stringer, SR. Okay, and if you compute, you use the W represent the uniformly distributed load, and you can see each meter of this stringer will support the area of 3 square meter. And since the load on the deck is 10 kilonewton per square meter, so if you put 3 meter, that is going to per meter, so we keep this 1 meter in our mind. And it's time what? 10 kilonewton per square meter. So the uniformly distributed load here is going to be 30 kilonewton per meter of the stringer. And since we assume this stringer, okay, as the simple beam, the problem also asks us sketch the loading. We are sketching of the stringer already. And then they also ask us about the related assumption. So the stringer must be assumed is a simple beam we assume it's as a single beam, and actually not is, are, and are supported by pin and rollers. Okay, by pin and roller. So this means we got to assume, if we assume S as the pin, so we're gonna have this one as S sub Y and this one as S sub X. And also we have this as the R sub Y. So this is going to be statically determinate beam. And also when you draw the free body diagram, don't forget to put the reference X and Y axis, because we're going to use the summation of X sub X equal to zero. When we use this, we're going to get S sub X equal to zero. And then to determine the S sub Y and R sub Y, you may use the summation of moment. Let's set it as the S, okay? As the S equal to zero. By doing this, you will get the R sub Y. The R sub Y gonna time what? Gonna time 4. Okay, that is going to rotate counterclockwise of the S. So if this is positive, the resultant force here gonna produce the moment in the opposite direction. So this is going to be 30 kilonewton, okay, per meter. So it's going to be 30 kilonewton per meter. And the length is 4 times length 4. With what? The resultant gonna act at the centroid of the area. And this distance going to be what? Half of the 4 meter, so it's going to be 2 meter. So this one going to time 2. And then 4 cut 4, you will get R sub Y equal to what? 60 kilonewton. Okay. And then if you further by summation of F sub Y equal to zero and set it up as the plus, you will get what? You will get the R sub Y plus S sub Y. So S sub Y plus 60. And then it's going to be what? It's going to be equal to the resultant of the uniformly distributed loss of what? 30 times 4. It's going to be 120. And 120 minus 60. So your S sub Y is going to be 60 kilonewton. Okay. At this point, the reaction as the S is 60 kilonewton. That means the reaction for this tincture for the blue area also 60 kilonewton, because the width are the same, and also the orange. Since this tincture, let's say B palm B, I put the pink into it. Okay, have the length of 9 meter and also connected by the other tincture on the lower side. That means at this point, this pink tincture, sorry, this pink forebeam gonna take care of 2 reaction. Each of them is 60 kilonewton. So this is going to act by 120 kilonewton. And this also 120 kilonewton. And this one is also 120 kilonewton. So next, let's consider the forebeam. This forebeam is 9 meter. So this forebeam gonna have 4.5. Okay, and then it's going to act at this point, and this point, and this point. because it's connect by the stringer here, here, and here. 1.5, 3, 3, 1.5. This is 1.5. This is 3 meter. This is 3 meter. And this is 1.5. And the force that's act upon it is going to be this one. This one. This is for the light blue, for the yellow, and for the orange. Okay, and you get the force from the orange here, the force from the yellow here, and the force for the light blue here. And it's going to be 60 times 2. That is going to be 60 times 2 and equal to 120 kilonewton. 120 kilonewton. And this one also 120 kilonewton. And again, you get to make assumption for the floor beam. Okay, floor beam. Are a kind of simple beam. Again, and are supported, the same thing, supported by pin and roller. Okay, so it's up to us. This point is going to be B palm, and this point is going to be B. And let's see if this is roller, so this is only B sub Y. And if this point is pin, it's going to be, this is B palm sub Y, this is going to be B sub Y. And also over here is going to be B sub X. And what we have now is we're going to determine the reaction. So the model of the stringer subjected to uniformly distributed load. However, the model from this forebeam, let me put the pink into it, is going to be the beam, simple beam subjected to 3-point loading. Next, we're going to determine the reaction. So if you summation of x sub x equal to 0, this is x, this is y, you will get the b sub x of what? B sub x of 0. And then if you like, you may take the summation of the moment, let's see, b palm equal to 0. You take this, the b sub y must time the length of this forebeam. The length is going to be 9 meter. So you're going to have 9. Okay, time what? Time b sub y. And it's going to what? It's going to rotate counterclockwise, is positive. So this one is going to be equal to what? Equal to 120 times 1.5 plus 120 times 4.5 plus 120 times 7.5. Okay, and then you will get the b sub y of what? 180 kilonewton. Okay, and finally, if you like summation of f sub y equal to 0, you will find the b sub y palm. So the b sub y palm upward plus 180 upward, and then it's gonna equal to 120 plus 120 plus 120. This is going to be 360. 360 gonna minus 180. So B sub Y palm is going to be 180 kilonewton. Okay, You may see that by using the equation of equilibrium to find the reaction of this tincture and this forebeam. Since the tincture here and the forebeam has the symmetry about its midspan, and you can notice that the reaction that we have on this is 60-60, on this is 180-80 is equal. So it should be noted. It should be noted. If the beam is in symmetry, okay, the reaction on the left and the right hand side of the beam is equal. For example, here you may set B sub Y equal to B sub Y part. So this is gonna help you to reduce the time that's used to compute the reaction a little bit, okay, if you like. And then we move to do the model for the task. Okay. Oh, before you move to the model of the task, don't forget about one thing. We have also the forebeam on the exterior portion as the AA palm and also in the EE palm. This forebeam will subjected to the force transferring from the deck in only in one forebeam. So with one stincture. So what it means that the model of the forebeam A palm A will a little bit different from the model from the beam B palm B by doing this. Let us elaborate more on this A palm A forebeam. Okay, this is going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.5 by the scale we use. This is going to be 9 meter, so 2 meter for 1 centimeter. This forebeam, the green one, is going to be A palm A, and then the loading that act on it is going to be only half of the B palm B. So by doing this, since it's subjected to only half of this beam, so this is going to be 60 kilonewton, and this one going to be 60 kilonewton, and this one 60 kilonewton. And by doing so, the reaction A palm sub Y and the reaction over here is going to be A sub Y, and here is going to be A sub X. The A sub X is 0. And due to the loading over here is only half of this, you may say this one is going to be 90 or 180 divided 2 equal to 90 kilonewton. And this one is 90 kilonewton. Since the applied loading are 1/2 compared to the forebeam, yeah, the forebeam, B palm B. The reaction are 180 divided by 2 is going to be 90 kilonewton. You may give this lesson to reduce the calculation load of this problem. So in conclusion, what we have is the load from the decks, okay, transfer to the stringer, and then the load from the stringer transfer to this forebeam and get this model and to this forebeam, and then we get this model. At this part, what we have, the force that's going to act at A is going to be the 90, and the force that's going to act at the B is going to be 180. So next, we can draw the model of the thrust, okay? But before I do that, just make some assumption for the thrust. The thrust are a simple thrust. Okay, and supported by pin and roller. Okay, we will follow the assumption and we will draw the model for the thrust. Let us move to the next page of this, and we can reduce the three-dimensional thrust into the model of the Pana thrust. Okay, by considering this, using this, we may say this thrust is what? This thrust going to have 4 meter, 4 meter, 4 meter, and then you may say the thrust going to be what? 8 meter long. Let's see, this is going to be like, this is AB, BC, CD, and DE. That's all the member of the thrust. And it's going to connect by the pin, and this is going to be A, B, C, D, and E. Okay, our thrust gonna have 3 meter tall. So if 4 meter you use centimeter, 3 meter is going to be 1.5. Okay, this is going to be 1.5 and 1.5, and then you connect the top chord. This called the top chord of the thrust, and the other is the bottom chord. Okay, if you draw it like this, you may take the element like this, and the joist is going to be pin. Okay, and then you connect the diagonal. This called the diagonal member. Okay, and the bottom called the bottom chord. Okay, since we assume one is the pin and then another one is the roller, okay, and we also can draw the model. This is diagonal and this diagonal. Okay, let's me just skip to the A as the pin and the E as the roller by putting the reaction A sub Y and A sub X directly to reduce the time for drawing the whole model. And this one gonna be what? The E sub Y. And then we got the spacing between the point. This one is 4 meter. This is 4 meter, 4 meter and 4 meter. And then what we get? What we get is the force that's X on the point B, point C, and point D. Also point A and point E. This is going to be 90 kilonewton. This is going to be 180 kilonewton, 180 kilonewton, 180 kilonewton, and 90 kilonewton. Okay. We finish drawing the free body diagram of the truss. The bottom, this is called the bottom cord. Okay. And then this truss is statically determined truss. Okay. And we can use the summation of the moment at A is equal to zero. If we take the moment here equal to zero, we will get the E sub Y. So the E sub Y gonna rotate counterclockwise as the positive. So we have E sub Y. E sub Y gonna time what? E sub Y gonna time 4, 4, 4, 4, 16. Okay, and also what? Also we're going to have, this is counterclockwise. The other applied forces going to rotate in opposite direction, the 90. The 90. 90 is gonna time what? Gonna time 16 also. Okay, 180. 180 is gonna time what? 12. Plus 180 times what? 8. And then 180 gonna time 4. And then you put all of this in your calculator, you will get the E sub Y equal to 360 kilonewton. Okay. And the other, you're going to find the A sub Y, just summation of F sub Y equal to zero. And upward is positive. So you get the A sub Y. And then this one, plus 360, all are upward. And then the other is downward, 90, gonna time 2, 180. Gonna time 3. And then if you put everything together, you will get the A sub Y equal to 360 kilonewton. As I mentioned before, if the structure is in symmetry, the distribution of the force on both sides gonna be the same. And the last one, if you have summation of X sub X equal to zero, and then you may get the A sub X equal to zero. So this is zero. This is 360 kilonewton. And this is also 360 kilonewton. Okay, next step, we're going to analyze the truss to determine the forces in its members. So let me take this one out, okay, and we are going to work from the model that we have over here, over here. Okay, by doing this is a better practice to separate the portion of the section into half. Okay, let's say take one is in half. Okay, they're going to ask us to find a lot of forces, okay, in the task member, and you may see that's gonna include the AF, BF, BG, CG. Okay, by doing that, let me take the color for the this one, if an AF, this one the member AF, and this one is the G, so this one gonna be the BT, this one is gonna be the BT, and also they ask us to determine the BF, the BF is here, okay, and the last one is the CD. So by asking a lot of this thing, you may see that we will apply both the method of choice and method of section to analyze this task. Let me start by finding the force in the member AF first, and then we will determine the force in the member BF. Since the AF is near the support, to analyze this, we got to cut the joists, and then we use the free body diagram of joist A. When we finish drawing the free body diagram of joist A, we will use the equation of equilibrium at the joist to determine the forces in this member and this member. Okay, let's first find the force in task member AF. Okay, yeah. And also N. If you like, AB. We start by what? Okay, by doing this, let me put a little bit like this. Okay. And take the joist A out of the truss. A is here. And then we get what? We put the reference axis, XY. And then we put the no force. We have two no force here. This is going to be here, 360 kilonewton. And also the 90 kilonewton here. Okay. And then, as I mentioned before, when the task subjected to the force like this, it's going to bend like this. And then the member AB gonna be in tension. When it's tension, the arrow gonna point out of the joist. And also, since this one is upward, so this force in the member AF gonna be in compression to balance the 360 kilonewton. I give this name of F sub AF. Okay. And then we got to find the angle the F sub AF act to the horizontal. Since this is 3 meter and this is 4 meter, we also can put the ratio here. It's going to be 3. This one going to be 4. Okay, we finish drawing the free body diagram of joist A. It's going to be complete like this. Next, what equation we should use first to find the forces. Summation of x sub x equal to 0 or summation of f sub y equal to 0. If you select summation of x sub x equal to 0, you project this force into the horizontal and then you write down the equation. You didn't get the solution because there are two forces in this equation. So it's better to start by summation of f sub y equal to 0 for this free body diagram, because when you project this force into the vertical direction, there is only one unknown there. Okay, and then let me put positive part up what is positive. So what we get is 360 is positive. And then the 90 minus 90. And then the component of this one here of the f sub af is going to be minus what? Minus f sub af. And since the component is in vertical direction, so the ratio here gonna be what? Gonna be 3/5. And then you make it equal to 0. By putting this into the calculator, you got to do it slowly and surely. And then you going to get f sub af equal to 450 kilonewton. And since this f sub af point into the joint, so this is in compression. See, you use this equation, you will get the solution directly. And then next, you use the summation of x sub x equal to 0. So this time you put this one as the positive. And then you will get f sub ab over here is going to be positive. And this guy, when you project on the horizontal, is going to be equal to 450. And when you project in the horizontal direction, so you're gonna times 4 and then divide it by 5. And finally, you will get this one of 360 kilonewton. And since is pointing out, so this one is in tension. Okay, now we know the force here and we know the force here. What should we use? Which joint we should use to determine the force in the member BF? If we consider this, the joint B, even do you know the force in the member AB, there are still unknown three forces. So we cannot use joint B. Now we move to joint F. In the joint F, we know the forces in the pink member. So you can find the force in this blue member and this one. So next, let us find the forces. Find D. Let's see. F sub B. F sub F B. N. We also can find F sub F G. Okay, this one. Okay. Just take the joint F. Okay, over here to draw the free body diagram and put the reference axis here, XY. What we have is the force F sub AF will point to the joint since it is the compression force. Compressive force in compression. So this one is going to be 450 kilonewton. And don't forget, it's going to have the ratio of 3/4. Next, when the task subjected to the force like this, the bottom chord, okay, get the tension, the top chord go to be in compression. So for sure, this member F sub FG gonna be in compression. And then it's going to balance by the component of this force. And if you project this 400 kilonewton to the y-axis, you will see the component of the 450 kilonewton going to be upward. That means the force in our blue member gonna be downward. So this force F sub FB should be in tension like this to balance the component of the 450 kilonewton force. Okay, let me summation. So which one going to use first? For this free body diagram of joint F is very special. You can use any one. You will get the answer directly. So let me put summation of F sub Y equal to zero. And let me put the downward as the positive. So we have what? We have this one project into this direction is going to be upward. So it's going to be minus 450. And then it's going to be time what? The component of 450 gonna time 3 divided by 5 to project it in the vertical direction. And then our F sub FB is downward plus F sub FB equal to 0. So you get the answer of F sub FB of what? F sub FB of 270 kilonewton. And since is out of the joint, is tension. Okay, and then the last one, summation of X sub X equal to zero. We got this one, put this one as the positive. So we have F sub F G positive. This guy when project into the X direction is have the opposite direction to F sub F G. So it's going to minus 450. And then for the horizontal component, it's gonna time 4 divided by 5. Okay, and then equal to 0. So you will get F sub FG equal to this one, 90. Okay, and then this one going to be 360, 90 times 4 kilonewton. And it's in what? It's in compression. Okay, so we finish finding the forces in the task member that are close to the support. Next, we are going to cut the section of the task, okay, to find the force in member BG. Ah, okay, we find F sub BG. Okay. And also, we can find F sub BC also. If we cut the section, we start by drawing the section of the task. This one is going to be AB, and we have this one is F. So we have the portion of the A, B, F. This portion of the task is subjected to reaction 360-90 kN. The force from the stinger 90 kN, and also the force from another stinger. This is 180 kN. This is inside stinger. This is outside stinger. And the length here is 4 meters. And the length here is 3 meters. Since the task is in equilibrium under the force, if you cut the task, the portion of the task also in equilibrium. Okay. And then from the previous choice analysis, we get this one as what? As 360. So this is a compression. Just put this one is 360 kilonewton. And the member here are sure it's going to be in tension. You can bend this one as this is tension. This is going to be F sub BC. And the required diagonal member is here. Just put this one up. This one going to be F sub BT. Okay. And the angle of this can put into the ratio of 3 and 4. Okay. At this point, you can see that we have two unknown. That we going to determine. And what do you think we supposed to use? Okay, should we use the summation of moment anywhere? Or should we use the summation of the forces in the x equal to 0 and summation of the forces y equal to 0? Since we know this one already, okay, and it looks to me that it's really convenient if we project this one into the vertical direction. And then we will have the component of this unknown force with the less of this. So we can determine this F sub BG easily by summation of F sub Y equal to 0. No need to taking the moment at any point. By doing this, let's set this one up is positive, and then you can see that the component of this F sub BG is going to be upward. F sub BG is upward, is positive, and then in its vertical, so it's going to time 3 divided by 5. This is the upward. So what else is upward? Plus 360 is upwards, and then minus 90 here, and then minus 180 here, and then equal to 0. We can see that our F sub BT is going to be what? Do the computation. It's going to be, this is 360, this is minus 270, so it's going to be 90, right? And then you move it to the right, so this is going to be minus 90 times 5 over 3, and it's going to be minus 150 kilonewton, or it's going to be 150 kilonewton with the compression. Okay, we get F sub BT in compression, and then we taking the summation of X sub X equal to 0. So we're going to find the F sub BC. So this time our F sub BC is here, and this one is going to be plus F sub B, G, and its horizontal component is going to be times 4 over 5, okay? And it's going to be in the same direction from this picture, and equal to 360. By drawing like this, you choose to recall this guy is going to be minus 150, as you will get here. Okay. By doing this, you will get F sub BC equal to 360. And then this is minus, is going to be plus 150 times 4 over 5. And this is going to be 120. So the result here is going to be 480 kilonewton. And the BC point out from the joint, so it's going to be in tension. Okay. So we have the forces of these two members. The last one, they asked us to find the force in this member. So this time you use the right portion of the thrust. And then we draw the free body diagram. Again, we have this is point D. This is point E, and the last one is point H. Okay, this is point H. And then we have the reaction here of 360 kilonewton. And again, the force here is what? 90 kilonewton. And the force here is going to be 180 kilonewton. And by considering the deformation of the thrust, we know that this is going to be in tension. It's going to be F sub CD. And this one going to be in compression. This is going to be F sub GH. And the diagonal member is here. That is going to be F sub DG. Okay. They require us to find this F sub CD. So by considering this phi, only F sub CD. Okay, you may project these forces to this point G, and since this one is 3 meter, this one 4 meter, and this one 4 meter, this is better to take the moment about point G to obtain the F sub CD by this case, right? Just summation of moment about G equal to zero. Since this force rotate what clockwise about G, so the clockwise rotation is positive. And the moment arm between the F sub CD and point G is 3 meter, so it's going to be 3. And then F sub CD in this direction. And also, if you notice, the 90 kilonewton also rotate clockwise about G, so plus 90. And the 90 is gonna time what? The 90 have the line of action here, so it's gonna time 8. Okay. And how about this? This also rotate in the same direction, plus 180. 180 have the line of action here, is going to time 4. And then this one going to equal 360. 360 have the line of action the same as 90 kilonewton. So is going to have F. So we got F sub CD equal to 480 kilonewton, and is in tension. Okay, we obtain everything that they ask. Okay, and now let's make conclusion. What forces do we have in the task from our calculation? We have the task of this one, A, B, C, D, and E. Okay, and this is the top chord. The other below is the bottom chord, and the inclined member called diagonal member. Diagonal member is diagonal member. And then what we have is the results of our calculation. We have what? We have this is 360 kilonewton, and also this is 360 kilonewton, and is subjected to the force of 90 kilonewton, 90 kilonewton. And then you may see the force that we has is going to be what? Since the structure is in symmetry, so the reaction are equal, and then the force will separate. The 90, the 180 is at the middle, so it's going to separate 90 on the left and 90 on the right. So the force 360 can be computed by adding 90 with 180 and another 90 here. That is 360. Okay. So when the structure is in symmetry, you got to know that the obtained reaction both on the left and on the right are equal. And then we have what? We have F sub, what? F sub AF of minus 450 kilonewton. This is in compression. And this one is the AB. AB is plus 360. And then we go to F sub, FB, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, okay. And this one gonna be what? This one gonna be plus FB, 270. And this one gonna be minus 360. And then by the calculation, we have the BG of minus 150. And then the last one that we have is what is the BC. BC is here. BC is also plus 480. And then F sub CD we get plus 480. See, you can see by the symmetry of the structure. Actually, we can analyze the structure by only half. And the result of the internal thrust member force, the result of the force in the thrust member is going to be the same. This is going to be 360. This is minus 450. And this is going to be minus 360. This is going to be plus 270. And this is going to be minus 150. Only one member here, you can prove it. The force in this member will be plus 180. You can prove it. Let you prove the force in this member by yourself. Okay. try to check it. 3180. So what you have from here is what? You get the maximum tension equal to what? And what do you get for the maximum compression? How many kilonewton? Do you just make the conclusion from the picture? And you can see that the tension going to be 480. And the compression going to be 450. And when you decide the member in tension, you will use the mechanics of material, chapter 1. Okay, you can decide this tension member. And if you decide the compression member, you should use chapter 1 plus chapter 13. After you use chapter 1, you can determine the section of the member. And since the tension member have no problem about buckling, unlike the compression gets buckling. So this one, after you get the section, you got to check whether the obtained section have the buckling strength larger than the required one. Okay, let me a little bit elaborate more about the design of this truss member based on the tension. Going back to the truss, most of the truss built by the steel and typical steel such as the A36 steel from the STM have the sigma supply of 250 megapascal. And then in the design, you got to use the factor of safety that may account for the construction error, the erosion that occur on the truss, or the unexpected forces from the heavy typhoon, something like that. So we put this of 2.0. So our sigma allow can be 250 divided by 2 is 125 megapascal. Okay. In the design, the maximum stress, sigma max, in which we have here is 480 kilonewton, is going to divided by the required area. And then it's going to set equal to sigma allowable. And then from this, we can determine the A required easily. Sorry for that. Okay. And then the A required is going to equal to what? 480,000 Newton. And then it's may divided by 125 million Newton per square meter. Or you may divide 480,000 Newton by what? By 125 Newton per square millimeter. So it's up to you which way you like. And then this is going to be 3,840 square millimeter. Or if you may use this, it's going to be 38.4 centimeter square. So when you get this area, you may select the section of the truss member based on the standard steel section manual. As you may show here, this is one of the products from the Siam Yamato Steel Industry, or SYS. If you check this, you may see the required area. They set it in square centimeter. If you compare 38.4 with the given cross-sectional area, the first one, no, second, no, the third is okay, but it's very large compared to 38.4. 48.79, okay, that is a little bit larger. It's pretty close to this. This is larger, 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 larger. So the closest one that we can use is going to be this one. So we may select the what? The I section with what? 250 times 125, that means the H is going to be 250 millimeter, and the B is going to be 125 millimeter. And then it's going to have the weight of 38.3 kilogram per meter. So each meter of this section gonna be 38.3. And the standard of this I-beam is follow the TAS, Thai Industrial Standard, Thai Industrial Standard 1227-1996 is the Thai Industrial Standard. We have talking about this in the material testing also. Okay, if we use work in different country, we're going to use the different standard, such as you may use the JAS in Japan, that is Japanese Industrial Standard, or ASTM, American Society for Testing and Materials Standard. They are different. Or if you like, you may select the other section, like if you like to use the T, okay, the T, you may select the T to use in this bridge task. And you can see, no. Okay, this one is good. A little bit larger than this, and it's star. That means you got to call the SYS, is special section. No. And this one also good. This is available. Okay, you may select to use this section. So another one, if you follow this, you may use the T section. That is going to be 125 times 250. With the weight of 32.2 kilogram per meter, so this is a little bit lighter than the previous section. Okay, this is the example that cover the bridge task from the start upload distribution to the analysis of the task and to the design of the task member resisting the tension. Actually, you may use this section to check if it can take, it's for sure, can take 450 kilonewton, but you can check the bucking strength of this section, okay, by checking the P critical equal to pi square EI over L square. From the section, from this section, you will know the I, and the length of the section AF is going to be 5 meter. Okay, and check whether how much this one is. For the bucking force, okay, if the bucking force is less than 480 kilonewton, you are safe to use this section. If the particle of this section, okay, is smaller than this, that means you got to select a larger section for the section AF and section HE. Okay, this is all I have for this example. It took us about 1 hour 40 minutes for this example. Anyway, I think it's worth the time. It's worthwhile to take this time for this example, since it tell you about the whole picture of the analysis and design of our task. Okay, and I hope you understand the whole process of this, and you can practice this and have some skill to use this in your future. Okay, bye bye.